we stand for Bible reading.
Our reading the Bible is God's only to understand the vision. Therefore, we teach our standing of the word. God has created you to live his word, and I shall share our plan of salvation with the lost. Our open word is respectfully, study it prayerfully, and obey it completely. I will order my life according to his commands, his principles, and his precepts. This is my Bible. It is true, powerful, living word of God.
Amen.
Thank you. Have a seat.
For those of you that don't know me, my name is Sean. I heard a quote once that said, every encourager needs an encourager. So with today being Father's Day, I'm glad that Pastor Jay gets a chance to sit down and actually enjoy the service. He's not bringing the word today. So while we are continually praying for him, let's please say a prayer with and for the person who is, who happens to be my mother.
Amen.
If you haven't had a chance to speak to any of our deacons or get to know them, I suggest that you do. We have an amazing team here.
Amen.
And the fact that really any of them could step in at a time when it's needed for someone to bring the word and Pastor Jay needs to rest, I think is an awesome thing. I don't believe that every church has that, that every church is deacon board or elders can really get up and speak and really bring the word. It's an awesome thing that Pastor Jay trusts him to do that. So the word today is called Uncommon Father. So please just pray for and with my mom as she brings the word today. She's very important to me, and I'm so excited to hear what she has to say.
Call me,
call me,
I'm going to have.
choir spoke about gratefulness.
Yes.
I know I'm extremely grateful to be able to stand today.
Yes.
And I thank my spiritual father, my pastor, Pastor Jay, for trusting the God in me to be able to stand here. And then they spoke about, they sung about strong finish. And they asked me if it was a particular song I wanted. I said, no. I said, but sing that one last, because I think you start out weak. But it's not about how you start out. It's about how you finish. Amen. We're talking about a strong finish. So all of you remember that. It's not about how you start. It's about how you finish.
You're not a preach, Bishop.
Yeah. And happy Father's Day. And that goes to all of you. Even those that are just father figures. You don't have to have biological children, right, Ray? Your father figure. You know, I have to think about my father. This makes me reflect on my father. And he's been going what seems like 10 short years now. But he was an awesome man. He had a quiet strength. Always there for our family. And there is two main memories I have of my father that always make me smile. And one of them is every time he would leave the house, and if he drove in my direction, I'd run out in the middle of the street and I'd jump up and down, wave my arms and get him to stop. He would stop. He knew what I wanted. I'd always say, Daddy, bring me home a comic book. And he always brought me home one or two comic books. Never failed, every single time. And by the time I left the house, I had a huge collection of comic books. And probably my favorite memory about my father is when I was in grade school. How many of you had show and tell in elementary school? For those of you who didn't, the students would bring something to class, and they would tell the class about it and explain about it, and then the class had in turn had a chance to ask them questions. Well, my father was a mailman. He was a postal carrier for over 32 years. He was also a certified electrician. He had his own TV repair shop. And he also loved to cook. He was a chef. And how many of you remember Jimmy Hoffa? My father worked at the restaurant. He was the chef at the restaurant, Marcus Red Fox, that Jimmy Hoffa got kidnapped from. Never to be heard of again. But for show and tell, I asked my dad to come with me. And so I had him dressed up in his mail carrier uniform. And he came to class, and I introduced him to my class. And they asked him questions. He told them all about his job, and they asked important questions like, did dogs chase you? And how much mail did you carry? And was it heavy? You know, and he had his hat, which was, it looked like a bus driver's hat at that time, nice and round. And also had a big brown leather bag that was on wheels. And so he brought all that to class with him. And my dad was the hit of the day for show and tell. And I was so proud of my daddy. And I never forgot that my dad let me take him to school for show and tell. I get emotional when I think about the things that my father did, not only for his family, but for others, because he was such a giving person. And like I said, he had quiet strength. He was always even keeled. It was a rare moment when you saw him upset. I could use some more of that, you know, myself. You know, don't be shaking your head, Pastor. I want you to know it's not always the big, huge things that you do for your children and for others that make an impact. A lot of times it's the small things, things that you think are inconsequential that make a lasting impact on your children and on others. So don't negate anything that you can do for others. You know, when I compared my father to my friend's father, I saw a difference in a lot of them. And that brings me to my title today and the scripture, The Uncommon Father. And like they read, it's coming out of Matthew 1:18-25. I don't want you to stand. I'm just going to read verses 19 through 20. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. Can you turn this mic down just a little bit, please? But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream,
saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. We read a lot about various fathers in the Bible. We hear a lot of stories from the beginning of their lives to the end. But there's one father that we don't have a whole lot of specifics about. And that is Joseph, the earthly father figure of Jesus. You know, there's a lot of songs out there about Mary. Mary, don't you weep. Mary's song in the Bible. There's so many songs about Mary that they have a collective name for them. They call them the Marian hymns. And that's mostly in the Catholic and the Lutheran church. Oh, you'll find some songs about Joseph, but nothing compared to Mary. Sometimes I feel like Joseph doesn't get his just due. Kind of an unsung hero, so to speak. We do have his genealogy starting from Abraham to Jacob, Joseph's father. And that's important for us to have because that shows us that Jesus, through Joseph, had legal royal lineage. Still, most of the focus is on Joseph. And we know he just kind of quietly fades into the background, never to be read about or heard about again. The last thing we hear about Joseph is when Jesus was 12 years old in the book of Luke, when Mary and Joseph took Jesus to the Passover festival. And unknowingly, Jesus was left behind, wasn't he? You know the story. When they went back to find him, what did he say? You should have known I'd be about my father's business, amen? But we'd be amiss if we didn't talk about the great man and the examples that Joseph gave us. Mary was special, but Joseph also was special. Just as God chose Mary to be the mother on earth for Jesus, to be the mother of the Messiah, he chose Joseph to be the surrogate father figure on earth for Jesus. At least we know up until the age of 12, which were important formative years. So he was important in Jesus' life. God trusted him with Jesus. And when God uses a person, as he used Joseph, there's sacrifices to be made. And I'm sure that Joseph made plenty of sacrifices raising Jesus. But I'm just as sure that they were fulfilling ones. And when you think about Joseph, he couldn't have been just the average, common person of that time. I know he didn't know what he was really getting into, you know, but when he was betrothed, hooked up, and set up with Mary, he didn't know exactly what he was getting into. Think about if his friends or one of his, a prophet even, mostly, had come up to him and said, Joseph, I see in your future that you're going to be engaged to this lady named Mary, and she's going to say that she's pregnant. And you haven't been with her. And she said that no other man had been with her either. And to top it all off, she said that someone else that she's pregnant by is the Holy Spirit. Now, how do you think that sounded back then? If someone had walked up to him and said that, he probably would have ran in another direction as fast as he could. And you can't blame him. Now, I dare say that most of you guys out here, if you imagine yourself in Joseph's situation, this is a rhetorical question. But how many of you would have taken into consideration her reputation? And how many of you would not want to have disgraced her if you felt she'd done you wrong? Probably not many. He could have faced a lot of humiliation marrying someone who's pregnant, especially during that time. When they got to counting up the days and counting up the wedding month and comparing all the dates, they knew it didn't matter, didn't add up. And tongues wagged back then, just like tongues wag today, amen? You know somebody would have something to say. But Joseph was different. The Bible referred to him as a just man, meaning he not only believed that in doing the right thing, but he believed in doing it the right way. Now, come on, somebody. You know we can know what the right thing is.
Yes.
But that doesn't mean we're going to do the right thing. The custom then was that a man and woman were betrothed. They were engaged for a year before they were actually married. This was basically a legal contract between families. It was binding and could only be broken by divorce or death. The consummation of the marriage didn't take place until after the wedding. Now, the consummation of the marriage was supposed to take place after the wedding. We got way away from that, didn't we? Joseph, during this time, had the right to change his mind. All he needed were two men to agree that he could have a divorce, and it was done. A reason wasn't even needed. Some of you probably wish it was like that now. If Mary had been intimate with someone other than Joseph, she could have been accused of adultery. She could have been guilty of adultery. And according to their law, she could have been stoned to death. Again, Joseph wasn't like a lot of others. He couldn't have just blended into the crowd and followed along with what everyone else did, whatever was popular at the time. The fact that he didn't want to bring shame and disgrace to Mary tells us a lot about his heart and his character, doesn't it? He chose to show love and mercy to Mary even when he thought he was wrong. He was an uncommon man who was chosen, called, and answered the call by God. He had a pregnant fiance, what they thought was an illegitimate child, and he made a huge decision. Rather than make a name for himself, he made a home for Jesus. Amen. Of all the men during that time, Joseph was chosen to stand at the front of the line. He was a blue-collar worker, a small-town construction worker, who said yes to God. God didn't want a common father figure then. He doesn't want a common father figure now. He wants uncommon fathers, and that's what you are called to be. We know that this world is full of common things, and this society wants us to make everything so commonplace that it's continually put in front of our faces, so that when we encounter those things, we aren't surprised and we're not shocked, and they just become everyday things to us. They become an acceptable part of everyday life. Politically correct. Well, you have to learn to be an uncommon father in this common world. I'm sure there are a lot of common things and viruses and different ailments that we would like to be able to get rid of, like the common cold. Even though there's not a real cure for the common cold, God has a cure for the common life.
Say that now.
Because there's nothing common about God. So that means if we're in Christ, we're no longer common. Amen. Because the word tells us that if anyone be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. In order to be uncommon, it doesn't take growing up in the right neighborhood. It doesn't take growing up homegrown in the suburbs of Detroit. And it doesn't take coming from a two-parent home. It doesn't take the correct affiliations or the right denomination, because there isn't one. What it does take is a life submitted to God. I'm going to give you three qualities. There's more, but I'm going to give you three qualities that Joseph had that you need to have in order to be an uncommon father. The first one is that he knew who he was and whose he was. That's why he recognized the message given to him in a dream by an angel as coming from God. The message told him to take Mary as his wife. He recognized that voice. The word tells us that my sheep knows my voice. Amen. And she shouldn't be following anything else but the voice of God. If you have answered the call of God, you are his child. You belong to him. And you too can know his voice. Be a man after God's own heart. Be an example to your household and those around you. The enemy wants you to suffer from a case of mistaken identity. Come on, somebody. You know he does. He doesn't want the truth of who you are, nor
the spiritual power you possess to be manifested in your life. When you don't recognize who you are and whose you are, you make the job of the enemy that much easier. And you make your spiritual defenses that much weaker. You, in essence, cripple yourself. You have to be confident in your identity as a child of God, a child of the Almighty, the Father above all fathers. And with that identity comes full access to the abundant life that Jesus offers us. You have to make a choice where you're going to draw your life strength from. Are you going to draw it from the world, or are you going to draw it from the life giver? We don't want the outside sources. You can't draw from the world. And know that what you have inside you can never be taken away.
Yes.
Nobody can take that from you.
Amen.
You remember David and the when he was fighting Goliath and the armor that he put on that was the king's.
Yes.
You know, we have to be like David when he took off the king's armor because it didn't fit right.
Uh-huh.
It was a hindrance.
Yes.
You know, so when we as Christians try to fight covered in the armor of the world, it doesn't work. It just doesn't fit right. So it hinders our movement. It hinders our fight.
Yeah.
Don't you know that God already designed all the armor that we need?
Yeah.
Do you really think that he would have left us ill-equipped?
Well.
It's all there for us. You just have to grasp those weapons. We can read in Ephesians 6, and you can turn there later. It outlines those weapons for us.
Yes.
And it starts by telling us that we have to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. It reminds us that we're not fighting against flesh and blood. So why are we always trying to pick up the weapons of the world when we are ill-equipped and they don't fit? We are not fighting against flesh and blood. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles, the trickery of the enemy. Amen. It also lets us know that these weapons are available to each of us. And it goes on to tell us that we need to secure our waist with truth. We need to put on the breastplate of righteousness and have our feet prepared with the gospel of peace. Above all, we need to take up the shield of faith. Put on the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is what? The word of God. Amen. So you need to step up and put your armor on. And you don't have to worry about it fitting, because our King makes sure it fits every child of God. Let God know that you're committed and that you're in it for the long run. He doesn't need you jumping in and jumping out. You know, your pastor sits up here and puts a foot out and puts a foot back in. Hokey pokey. That's not what the Lord is looking for. Let God know that you can be trusted by him. Imagine God looking down and choosing a man to raise his son. Joseph had his trust. You also can have that same type of trust. You should work to be the apple of God's eye. God's not interested in you flirting with him. He doesn't want you hot and cold. He doesn't want a part-time lover, neither do you. He gave it all for you. He wants all in return. You should be proud knowing that you've been adopted into God's family as his own, something that can never be taken away from you. Your biological family may put you out, act like they don't know you because you ticked them off, you said the wrong thing, you didn't give them what they wanted. God won't do that.
Amen.
When he opens his arms and takes you, it's forever. There is nothing or no one that can take that from you, and you have all the rights and privileges that come with being his child.
Amen.
But you have to know what they are.
Amen.
And you have to know how to use them. Amen?
Amen.
The word in Ephesians 2 and 10 tells us we are God's workmanship.
Yes.
That means we are his excellent creation.
Yeah.
God did a good thing when he created each one of us.
Yes.
You are God's work of art.
Yeah.
And God only makes unique, complete masterpieces.
Yes.
Now you may not know that you're complete, but you are.
Amen.
It's on the inside. You got to learn how to bring it out. You may not recognize that there's someone powerful within you that's waiting to come out.
Yeah.
You have to let him mold you and bring out that strong, perfected in Christ person. Now, you may not know this, and let me share this with you. And as quiet as it's kept, fellas, in a spiritual sense, women are not the only ones that can give birth to someone. There's something waiting in each and every one of you men that's waiting to come out.
Yeah.
It's that strong, spiritual, perfected Christian. The second characteristic, the second quality Joseph had is righteousness, which is righteousness. God will never draw near to those who don't draw near to him. That's because if we're not drawing near to him, we're operating outside of his will. And that's not where we want to be. We draw near by right living. Jesus' relationship with God was characterized by love and obedience. And if Jesus is our example, that means our relationship should be characterized by what? Love and obedience. The word says, if you love me, keep my commandments. You see, we have to get beyond basing everything we do and say on how we feel. That's what the world wants you to do. Oh, I feel bad today. I feel good today. I feel depressed today. God, a walk with God is not a touchy-feely thing. We should know that by now. Joyce Myers rightly stated when she said, we have to live beyond our feelings and do what's right. Then she goes on to say that she wonders if we're serving the little g God of our feelings more than the God of the Bible. We all should be wondering that. How many of you know that there's a danger in emotional living? Yes, it is. It's a big danger in emotional living because our feelings aren't real. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 14 and 12 that there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end is the way of death. It may seem right in the beginning. It may even feel right in the beginning, but if it's not of God, the end is death. We need to be strong in our convictions and live out our beliefs in our actions, knowing that we are blessed with every spiritual gift that God has for us. That's what the word says.
Yes.
The last quality is self-discipline. We are an undisciplined people, aren't we?
Yeah.
We live in a society that has a quick fix for just about everything. We look for an easy, quick way to get everything we want and to go everywhere we want to go. But the only true lasting way to have anything is by growing in God and disciplining ourselves in God and his wisdom, his word, and then applying it to our everyday life. Amen?
Amen.
Not just on Sunday when we all come here trying to look good and be on our best behavior, some of us. But not only on Sunday, but even when you walk out this door in the parking lot, you know, after the pastor says amen and gives a blessing and benediction for everyone to depart, you still need to have the same attitude. You still need to act the same way. You are a child of God. We can't say and not do. If our children see us not making time for God in our private lives, that tells them that it's not important, that they shouldn't place much value on it. What are we showing our children? I heard a story about this religious man, very religious man, and he wanted his family to always go to church, always do the right thing, always look the right way. And one of his sons grew up and decided he was going to go into the ministry. He also decided he was going to go overseas to study. And his father said, no, I don't want you to go overseas. They don't teach you the right stuff over there. They probably don't even know anything about Job or the book of Job. And well, the son decided he was going to go anyway. Before he left, he got his father's Bible and he just cut the book of Job out and took it with him, you know. And 2 years later, when he came back, the father looked at him and said, well, did they teach you about Job? And the son said, Father, you don't even have Job in your Bible. What are you talking about? And he said, yes, I do. And the son said, well, prove it. Father gets his Bible and he's flipping all through it, getting frustrated because he can't find the book of Job. He said, I don't know what happened. I know it's in here. It's supposed to be in here somewhere. Well, the son looked at him and said, "Father, what's the difference between the school not teaching me about Job and you never reading about him?" I said all that to say this. We have to be the example. We have to actually live it and not just talk about it. Now, you know, I'm going to get personal. Years ago when Pastor was a chaplain on the base, right, Pasadena Air Force Base, one Sunday he said, "It amazes me how many people I know really love the Lord, but don't know his word." And he also said, "Don't you know you can only know God as much as you know his word?" And that thing hurt me so bad, because he was talking about me. I love the Lord, and I love him. But I didn't take time to get in my word as I should. And I was one of those ones who come to church, sing in the choir, say amen, and had to search through my Bible if he said turn to Matthew. Much less Hezekiah. I knew I was grieving the Holy Spirit. And I made a decision that day that I would no longer resemble that remark. You know, I knew I was doing a disservice to my Christian walk. And I knew that I was grieving the Holy Spirit. And I also didn't want to treat God's grace as if it was cheap. Because there's nothing cheap about God's grace. We were brought with a heavy price. We have to move from knowing about Jesus to knowing Jesus. And that takes discipline and determination. We don't want to give up stuff, but you have to give up something to know Jesus. You have to make him first in your life. We have to follow him. And it's not always going to feel good. You may lose some people that you don't want to lose. But what is it worth to you? And we all have to decide if our growth, our perfection in Christ, and our relationship with him are worth fighting for. And I can tell you that yes, they are. The word tells us in Proverbs that every word of God is pure. That means it's been tried and found true. It goes on to say he's a shield to those who put their trust in him. Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. You have to believe what you read. You have to teach what you believe. And you have to practice what you teach.
Amen.
All of that is part of discipline. In closing, as Pastor likes to remind us, and he stood here and said it last week, and we all know it to be true, none of us will get out of this life alive. We all have one appointment without the benefit of cancellation, no matter what you do. All the material things we accumulate, all the cars we drive, all the big houses or little houses we have, no matter how you dress or how you look, it's all nothing in the end. When we leave this world, all you're going to have left here is the legacy that you left behind and the people, the impact that you made on people's lives. I talked about being an uncommon father. That doesn't mean that you have to have biological kids to be an uncommon father and be a positive father figure. Think of Apostle Paul as your example. He wasn't married, nor was he a natural parent, but he was a spiritual parent to many. And his legacy was so powerful that it lives on today and still helps to change our lives. Amen?
Amen.
I wonder whose life will you speak into? I wonder if there's anyone out here that will commit to being an uncommon father. And what will your legacy be? Amen. And that's all I have for you today. But I don't want to think that everybody in here may be saved. Just because you come to church every Sunday doesn't mean you're saved.
Come on.
I remember growing up, and this lady that I would see active in everything. One Sunday, the pastor gave the invitation, and she got up off her seat and started walking down the aisle. And you should have seen everybody. Heads turning. What is she doing? She had been there all the time, serving in the choir, serving on the usher board, being faithful, but she had never given her life to Christ. She decided that day that she wasn't going to be ashamed. She wasn't going to let fear hold her in that seat anymore. She got up and came forward. And I'm asking that anyone here today that wants to move from being common to uncommon, that you come and give your life to Christ. Also, if anyone has given your life to Christ and you've fallen out of fellowship with him, the world and all its ills and troubles have pulled you away, you no longer feel your right, we ask you to come also. Because God is married to the backslider. Once you're with Christ, he's always going to love you. No matter what you did, no matter who you are. And lastly, if we have any friends of New Season that make it a habit to come, but haven't joined, if you'd like to join with us, we'd love to have you.
Amen.
We have an awesome pastor who loves to teach and who teaches really well and who has a heart, he has a burden to make sure that we understand that word. And not only that we understand it, but that we know how to apply it to our lives. The word tells us in all our getting to get understanding. It doesn't do any good if you come Sunday after Sunday and you haven't committed your life to Christ. Do you know where you're going? Tomorrow isn't promised. Look at Florida. You can drop dead in here today. So if you don't want to come up in front, we do have intake counselors. You can see me after service. You